Hey, what's up? Hello. It's your girl, Queen Z. And if you're new here, welcome to Queen Z's World. To gain your citizenship to Queen Z's World, check out some of my older videos, comment on your favorite five, then come back here and let me know you did it. Get it? Got it? Good. Now, let's get into the video. There's a lot that can be said about this album, and frankly, it was a little intimidating. Lemonade had such a huge impact. There have been countless think pieces, parodies, and even some artists who have done visual albums and surprise drops.
And then I see people doing it now.
Oh.
With art, there are as many perspectives as there are people, and Lemonade is no different. We're not gonna talk about the hints that she dropped on Instagram, although Bustle did a hilarious and amazing job. We're not gonna talk about the dehydration from 2014 to when this thing dropped and we didn't know when it was coming, okay? If you know, you know. We're not going to go in depth on the celebration of Creole and Southern Black African American culture. The Dissect podcast on Spotify did a great job going track by track and giving the commentary, so I definitely recommend you check that out if you're craving a little more. But on today, we're gonna do something a little different. We're stripping back the prestige and we're breaking it down. We're gonna ask the art these questions. What is the artist saying? What is the artist not saying? What is my connection to this? And what spiritual themes do I see throughout? You'd be surprised on how many biblical themes are wrapped up in this. And I am so excited to get into all of that. This one is for the Beehive, but even if you're a casual listener or you just wanna hear my perspective on things, I will make sure that it's simple enough for you to follow along. All of the references mentioned will be in the description box below. So definitely check those out for the fuller effect, or if you're not quite sure what I'm talking about. In true academic fashion, I cite my sources. We will be referencing Lemonade, the film. If you have access to it, watch along. Even if you don't, that's okay. You can still understand this video if you haven't seen it. This is gonna be a whole trip, okay? So I'd love to hear what you're thinking. Get those typing fingers ready. We'll keep it respectful and cute. It's gonna be a doozy. So sit back, grab a snack, and sip that lemonade. With all that housekeeping aside, let's press play. If there's one thing B knows how to do, it's start an album. First thing we hear are the wordless noises that she makes. Kind of reminds me of when Ian LaVanzant is working with a client and they're crying silently and she's like, what's that sound? What's that sound? Give it a sound. It's like that sound of that pain. Here you'll hear like the background, there's the instrument and then her voice. And sometimes it's in sync, sometimes it isn't. This symbolizes how usually she's in sync with her partner. Usually they're on the same page, but now everything is just slightly off. And that sound, that huh, is kind of like her asking, huh, what was said? What was that? And she's trying to catch what he's not saying and trying to get back in sync. She's hoping that he'll slip up and say something or clue her in somehow. There's this unexplained imbalance, this lack of peace. In the end, she asks the question that she dares not ask out loud. What are you hiding? I love verse 2. Nothing else ever seemed to hurt like the smile on your face when it's only in my memory. It don't hit me quite the same. Maybe it's a cause for concern. Her partner is there but emotionally distant, and she just misses seeing him smile. Like, he's not happy around her anymore, and she wonders why. What happened? And this is where we start the album. Not jumping to conclusions, nothing, just asking why. The artist also introduces the theme of generational curses and family cycles, history repeating itself. She says in the poem, in the tradition of men in my family, you come home at 3 a.m. and lie to me. The past and the present emerge to meet us here. Whatever happens here will set the tone moving forward. There's a lot of pressure on this moment and on their marriage, really, to break the curse, break the cycle now before it continues to the next generation. The process of breaking generational curses is not glamorous. It's not fun. Like, I know it's something we all want to do, but it's really scary. It starts with that intuition, feeling like something's just not right and trying to identify it so that you can fix it. And often you feel a little crazy. You feel like, am I tripping? Like, you know, am I wrong? Like, is something off?
And they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man and said to him, "Where are you?" And he said, "I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and I hid myself." God said, "Who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten of the tree of which I commanded you not to eat?" The word of the Lord came to me, saying, "Go and proclaim in the hearing of Jerusalem, thus says the Lord, I remember the devotion of your youth, your love as a bride, how you followed me in the wilderness, in a land not sown. Thus says the Lord, what wrong did your fathers find in me, that they went far from me and went after worthlessness and became worthless? They did not say, 'Where is the Lord who brought us up from the land of Egypt, who led us in the wilderness in a land of deserts and pits, in a land of drought and deep darkness, in a land that none passes through, where no man dwells?'"
So the imagery we see next is actually some of my favorite. She steps off the stage, jumps, and lands in water. This is the part that I was like, I guess you hold your breath and you're like, oh. It's kind of like she's left reality. She's left the real realm, and now she's floating. She's dissociating. She's just there. Everything happens in slow motion. Now the poetry reveals that she's aware of her husband's infidelity. So what is she in denial of? The artist is in denial of her own emotions. Hysteria, an emotional state caused by grief or fear, accompanied by uncontrollable laughter, weeping, etc. A functional disturbance of the nervous system of psychoneurotic origin, an excited and exaggerated reaction to an event. This is from the Oxford Canadian Dictionary, second edition. The visuals are so cheerful. The song is upbeat. She opens the doors dressed like Oshun, and you just see the water rush at her feet. No longer is she stuck in her internal world. She's out in the open. She's in public. We see her dancing down the street, picking up a kid's baseball bat, frolicking around, really. Something very interesting is she never acknowledges the damage she's doing. Not once does B look back at the cars that she has smashed. Not once does she acknowledge the explosions happening behind her. Everything is cheerful and happy, with the exception of the explosions and the broken glass. In response to her own anger, she laughs. My favorite lyrics are in verse 2, when she just breaks it down and says, "Listen, these side chicks do not know you. They do not love the real you. Me and you have history. I was there before you became who you are today. They could never know you the way I love you. They could never love you the way I love you." She goes in, like, she absolutely drags him. But that's deep. That's really how she felt. Oh yeah, there's this phenomenon. I personally haven't experienced it, but you know, I've seen it on Twitter, where some people find other people more attractive when they know they're in a relationship. Now, some people have tried to rationalize this and say that, oh, it's because biologically, you know, you want to know that this person's capable of being faithful. So you see them in a different relationship and you're like, that's attractive. I want that person. Oh, hello, cat. I can't relate to that, but some people might. And B is just reminding him that, hey, they don't really love the real you. They just love that you're with me. I'm the one that they're looking at. I'm the one they want to be. They want my leftovers. There are so many hints throughout the whole visuals, right? It's all intentional. From the name of the bat, hot sauce. I got hot sauce in my bag. We're getting there. Okay, we're getting there. Formation, that's the last try. Just wait. Down to the surveillance camera having 4/23/16, which was the day Lemonade was dropped, all the way to the t-shirt the guy was wearing. It's kind of like she's sending that message of, I'm carefree, I don't care, in memory of when I cared. Now I'm going to dive into the samples, because that is where it gets real. All the best musicians are music lovers. We know this. And B loves music. Her taste is very diverse. Now the samples in this album tell a story. The samples are intentionally chosen, kind of like a playlist detailing her mood throughout the whole process. On the surface level, we have the lyrics of Hold Up, which are carefree, which are like, I ain't thinking about you, I'm good. They don't really love you. I'm the one who loves you the most. Who could replace me? Just that hysteric, heightened joy to hide the anger, right? The juxtaposition of the underlying message and the overt message are really telling of her emotional state at this point. The most prominent sample is Can't Get Used to Losing You by Andy Williams. Now, verse one of Can't Get Used to Losing You, this is exactly what we're seeing in the visuals. We're seeing her in public, dressed all nice, she's fancy, yet the lyrics in Can't Get Used to Losing You are saying, even though I'm out in public, it's lonely, it's empty without you. And that's really how she feels. Of course, you would only know that if you heard the sample. Okay, the second sample is just snuck in at the end. That Soulja Boy Tell Him sample, hop up out the bed, turn my swag on. That song is such a mood booster, confidence booster, but in context of what's happening, it's a bit confusing, and that's on purpose. The artist is trying to portray that I'm good, I'm fine, I'm confident, I'm still good, I'm all right. But underlying all of that is the sadness. And possibly she acknowledges the dehydration. I'm back again. Yep. I bet a lot of you thought I wasn't coming back. But really, this last sample is the last thing we hear before the music audio cuts and the environmental noises are very prominent. Kind of like here. She's leaving her internal world, her zoned in state. This time, her anger escalates.
To whom will you liken me and make me an equal and compare me that we may be alike? Those who lavish gold from the purse and weigh out silver in the scales hire a goldsmith, and he makes it into a god. Then they fall down and worship. They lift it to their shoulders. They carry it. They set it in its place, and it stands there. It cannot move from its place. If one cries to it, it does not answer or save him from his trouble. Do two walk together unless they have agreed to meet?
Honestly, a mood. Now, this is where we get the darkest imagery in her entire project. The line that stuck out to me was, I don't know when love became elusive. No one I know has it. There's a lack of positive role models of a healthy marriage in her life. Don't Hurt Yourself brings us to the iconic album cover of Lemonade, and we're back in the parking lot where these visuals started. It's kind of like she gave us a foreshadowing to this very moment. Anger. Also, anyone getting Me, Myself, and I vibes? Oh, it's something about like the parking lot, the fur, and it's also about a cheating partner, and it's kind of giving what it's supposed to give. Let me know what y'all think if you see that same connection. This is a rock track, which not only displays B's versatility, but really encapsulates the rage that she's feeling internally. I know y'all got chills at the end when she said,
this is your final warning. You know I give you life. If you try to do it again, you're
gonna
lose your life.
Yo, when she threw the ring at the end? Chills. And can we talk about that Malcolm X quote? The most disrespected, unprotected, and neglected person in America is the Black woman. There's a shortage of people who are willing to protect our emotions, protect our characters and reputation, and empathize with us as human beings. During this quote, we see regular everyday women just staring into the camera because that's really what it is. It comes down to that basic level. Doesn't matter if you're a Beyonce or if you're a regular girl, a regular woman, we all experience that same disrespect. And so anger is about the disrespect that is constantly given to us, even after we prove ourselves more than worthy, which no one has to do. Everyone deserves respect without having to prove it. But I just want to talk about that quote.
The most disrespected person in America is the Black woman. The most unprotected person in America is the Black woman. The most neglected person in America is the Black woman.
And since y'all not getting it, let me break down what respect looks like. Respect looks like not putting Black women like Lizzo on a pedestal and forcing them to become this image of what you wish you were, which they can never live up to. Respect looks like prosecuting the murderers of Breonna Taylor, who was killed in her home, asleep in her bed by an intruding police officer. Respect looks like justice being served
for Breonna Taylor and all the other Black women murdered by police,
whose names we don't even know, with the same energy that y'all gave George Floyd and Ahmaud Arbery. Same human being, same 9 months in the womb. We need it. Respect looks like reporting, not retweeting, videos of an underage Skye Jackson from the revenge that her ex posted online. Respect, and this is the one that made me cry, looks like not joining in on the laughs and the jokes when a woman tearfully reveals that she terminated her twin pregnancy, and instead of joking around, retweeting, talking about double homicide, we actually treat her with the sensitivity that this topic deserves, with empathy, with love, compassion, and we check people who get disrespectful with it. That's what respect looks like, treating Black women like actual human beings worthy of dignity and respect because we are, and we should not have to prove it. No one else does. Instead of seeing the humanity in us, you use us as GIFs, reactions, memes, and entertainment. Meanwhile, crimes against Black women, both cis and trans, go largely unreported. And why would we? Who defends us? Who's gonna do something about it? You'll grant innocence to the silence of our abusers before the bullet wounds in our feet.
I'm making it plain, yes. We will kill you for our woman. We believe that if the white man will do whatever is necessary to see that his woman gets respect and protection, then you and I will never be recognized as men until we stand up like men and place the same penalty over the head of anyone who puts his filthy hands out to put in the direction of our women.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. And when you tell this people all these words and they say to you, why has the Lord pronounced all this great evil against us? What is our iniquity? What is the sin that we have committed against the Lord our God? Then you shall say to them, because your fathers have forsaken me, declares the Lord, and have gone after other gods, and have served them and worshiped them, and have forsaken me, and have not kept my law, and because you have done worse than your fathers, for behold, every one of you follows his stubborn, evil will, refusing to listen to me. Therefore, I will hurl you out of this land into a land that neither you nor your fathers have known. And there you shall serve other gods day and night, for I will show you no favor.
So what are you going to say at my funeral now that you've killed me? Bonky to Lucius in season one. Ashes to ashes. Dust to side chicks. In other words, you're dead to me. In the song Sorry, B's just over it. She's like, I'm gonna be as selfish as you were, and I'm not gonna pick up the calls. I ain't talking to you about this. I'm just gonna try to forget you. It's just me and the girls. You ever been so mad you were calm? That's what Sorry is giving. It's giving so much of like, you know what? I'm not dealing with this anymore. I'm moving on. I gotta go. There's not much to say about this one, except it's iconic to see Serena Williams just twerking in the back. Sorry was the track that everybody knew about. You all know it. And it just gave us such catchphrases. Tell them boy bye. I ain't sorry. I ain't thinking about you. Becky with the good hair? Come on. Hi, I have a question. Album Sorry or Demo Sorry? Album Sorry is iconic, it's a bop, had its impact, you know? But Demo Sorry, there's just something haunting about it. Let me know which one y'all prefer. Was avoiding, thinking about her estranged husband. She sleeps all day, dreams of you in both worlds. Oh, I felt that one. Oh my gosh. Here, the artist is depressed. Her dreams and reality seem to merge, becoming one indistinguishable, muddied existence. Here, the visuals are red, fire, menstruation, and the red light district. Interesting combinations, right? In the song, the artist weaponizes her sexuality. It means nothing to her anymore. When the love of her life broke her heart, now nothing means anything anymore. In the lyrics, she describes throwing herself into her work in order to avoid thinking about or remembering him at all. In the visuals, B's eyes are empty, her expression emotionless. And any tears or sadness that you would see in her eyes is hidden by her wide-brimmed hat. Okay, we need to talk about the samples. We need to talk about the samples. Number one, Walk On By, performed by Isaac Hayes, is a heartbreak anthem. If you see me crying, walk on by. Pretend you don't see the tears. Let me grieve. I can't get over losing you. See, like I said, this is where the samples tell their own storyline. Because the lyrics of Walk On By, the message behind it, juxtaposes the message of 6 Inch. 6 Inch says, I'm numb, I'm forgetting about you, I'm throwing myself in my work, I'm about my business, I'm good, I'm focused. Walk On By says, I'm hurt, I'm broken, I'm in tears, I'm grieving, and no one sees it, so let's all pretend I'm fine. Overtly, 6 Inch is about being numb. Underlying all of that is heartbreak. At the end of the song, she barely breathes out her cry. She calls for her love to come back. Now, the second sample, that one's gonna blow your mind. Let me tell you something. This one is layered. First of all, the sample is harder to identify. She samples Animal Collective's chorus in the bridge of 6 Inch. She gon' slay, too smart to crave material things. She pushing herself day and night. She grinds from Monday to Friday, work from Friday to Sunday. Oh, oh. Okay, so that part is all about how she's working hard, getting her money, but she's not materialistic. Now, Animal Collective song, My Girl, is about working hard and just wanting the best for your family and not being materialistic about it, but just wanting them to have nice things. Layer number one. Now let's dive deeper. Layer number two, are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Check the lyrics. There isn't much I feel I need, a solid soul and the blood I bleed, but with my little girl and my spouse, I only want a proper house. When Lemonade came out, Blue Ivy, the child that Beyonce and Jay-Z share together, was under 5 years old. Through this sample, B is considering the effects that divorce will have on her young child, which we'll understand a little more in depth while analyzing the next song. For now, this sample hints at her longing just for her house to be in order and to be with her family reunited in a respectable way that she can model to her daughter.
Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to it. How often I would have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. Train up a child in the way she should go. Even when she is old, she will not depart from it.
In the poetry preceding Daddy Lessons, Beyonce clues us in to our location in the story. She takes a step back from her own experience and reflects on her parents' marriage. Comparing the differences and similarities, she says, "You look nothing like your mother. You look everything like your mother." The lipstick is kind of like wearing the disappointment on your face, yet hiding behind it. There's still a pressure to be composed, which is why the lipstick imagery is actually really symbolic. It's worth noting that Beyonce does not appear in the visuals in front of the camera at this time. Instead, we see regular Southern people in their locations, in their homes, in their towns, riding the horses, and it is just so country. That's why the accent's coming back out, man. Y'all know me and the Yeehaw agenda. I'm all with it. Daddy Lessons is about what Beyonce saw while watching her parents, Tina and Matthew Knowles, during their marriage. Tina and Matthew actually divorced when their daughters were in their 20s after Matthew impregnated another woman. Instead of continuing this cycle, B wants to just take a step back and reflect on what happened in their situation to make sure she doesn't repeat it. The curse is broken through asking for advice. Actually, this isn't the first song that Beyoncé has written for her dad. On her first album, Dangerously in Love, there's a song called Daddy. And in the lyrics, she wants her future husband to be just like her daddy. She wants her unborn son to be just like her dad. Now fast forward to this track on Lemonade. In the song lyrics, her father advises her if she ever meets a man like him, to shoot. Just a reminder to fathers, both those who have children, those who will have children, don't just teach your daughters how to avoid terrible men. Be the kind of man you want your son to be. If your son were to be just like you, is he someone that you would be proud of? Think about your legacy. And this is not out of shame. It's never too late to do better. But we do need to hold each other accountable. We do need to encourage each other to grow. We all have toxic cycles in our family that need to be broken. And we don't need to start any new ones either. It's never too late to look for role models and accountability partners. There's this message by Pastor Snell called Diary of a Happy Black Woman. Anyone who needs a blueprint for a positive relationship should check out that video. It's in the description down below. Oh my gosh, this is such a moment. The setting is on a plantation. This is to remember the women in her bloodline who've been through the same or similar marital struggle. There are flashbacks to the modern world. These olden day outfits in modern settings continues the theme of merging the past and the present. These are my favorite visuals on the entire album. Sunset and the ocean. If you want to understand the true essence and beauty of the song, watch the Grammy performance. That one, 100% recommend. In the poetry, she asks, why do you deny yourself heaven? Why do you consider yourself undeserving? Why are you afraid of love? You think it's not possible for someone like you, but you are the love of my life. Many people cheat because they don't feel worthy, because they feel like something's lacking or they don't deserve true love. But here, B reminds her partner, you are worthy of love. You're the love of my life. I love you. The Lord appeared to him from afar, saying, I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have continued my faithfulness to you. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. If my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and heal their land. The artist reminds the subject that their love is powerful. They are stronger together than apart. He doesn't need to run from love because he's not alone. She's right there beside him, loving him every step of the way. Still, it's honest. She knows that he's lying and she's trying to give him a chance and trying to be gracious, but she still feels like something's wrong. Still, despite all of this, she loves him through it. And I actually appreciate this about these love songs on Lemonade. They have complexity, they have range. Is that a dog or an? Me forgetting I'm in nature for like 5 minutes straight. The artist is saying, I understand that you're a nuanced human being, but I wish you would internalize the love that I'm sending you. Because it's real, it's genuine, it's powerful. Still, she asks the question whether or not he appreciates this deep love, or if he prefers a love that's superficial. Aw, I wish you could see the birds up there. Do you remember being born? Are you thankful for the hips that cracked the deep velvet of your mother and her mother and her mother? There is a curse that will be broken. If we're gonna heal, let it be glorious. I absolutely love the poetry and the imagery right here. I just wanted to start praise dancing. It's a peaceful moment, so I'm not gonna get hyped, but that part. This is where the generational curse breaks. Sandcastles. This is the moment everything has been leading up to. This poetry is a reminder that it's bigger than the two of them. This is about their bloodline, and this healing is long overdue. The lyrics are vulnerable and sonically it's stripped down. This is more of an acoustic song. Here, Beyoncé comes back and she says, "You did hurt me and I did leave as I have a right to, but I see the humanity in you. I still love you. And I need to know that you're willing to put in the work. I need you to show me your scars. I need you to prove to me that you want healing just as badly as I do, and that you will do what it takes to get this done." There's no fantasy world in forgiveness. We're brought back visually to the present moment. We only see B and J alone in their home, just the two of them. There's a line talking about broken dishes on the counter from a fight they had. That line is visually contrasted with the kintsugi bowl, a Japanese practice of mending broken pottery with gold. This makes it stronger than it was ever before. Yes, there were things said that no one can take back, but those pieces can still come together and they will be stronger than ever before.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love. According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only, I have sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and uphold me with a willing spirit. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you shall be clean from all your uncleanliness, and from all your idols I will cleanse you. And I will give you a new heart, and a new spirit I will put within you. And I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh, and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you, and cause you to walk in my statutes, and be careful to obey my rules. The latter glory of this house shall be greater than the former, says the Lord of hosts. And in this place I will give peace, declares the Lord of hosts.
Growth isn't linear. B is learning to trust her husband again, and her husband is learning to be trustworthy. Neither one is perfect. As she previously mentioned, they're like trees growing towards the same light, apart and together again. Even though the civil rights movement happened decades ago in our grandparents' and great-grandparents' day, we still have not really moved forward. In the song Forward, it describes this distrust explained by a past history of hurt. Okay, so I was listening to this podcast, Black Girls Heal, episode 95, on holding compassionate spaces for Black men. Often we forget they're at the intersection of masculinity and masculine presenting, which is accompanied by a whole bunch of things, including a limited range of emotions that are acceptable to share and express, and also being Black, which somehow became synonymous with being strong and high achieving, but somehow not human. This loss is different. She details the loss that we feel as a community every time one of our members is killed by the police, all because they felt threatened by our melanin and their projections of who we are. There's an attack on our community. The women you see in the video are mothers who have lost children to police brutality, and that's not even half of them. Black people are endangered. Not only Black men, but Black women, both cis and trans, are disproportionately killed by violence. Our deaths are rarely met with sympathy. Where's the comfort for the mothers?
Give justice to the weak and the fatherless. Maintain the right of the afflicted and the destitute. For I will satisfy the weary soul, and every languishing soul I will replenish. God saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. According to their deeds, so will he repay. Wrath to his adversaries, repayment to his enemies. To the coastlands he will render payment.
Freedom is that track that just gets you going, okay? This one is the pump up track. We are here to stay. You cannot take our voice away from us. My favorite line on the track is, I'ma keep running cause the winner don't quit on themselves, okay? This is that song of hope saying, we're not gonna give up, we are here to stay, and we will keep working towards what we want. In the sample, Let Me Try by Kaleidoscope, the musician promises to create a better world, a safe space, for the subject of the song. You have a right to exist. You matter. You add value to this world just by being here, and we will not stop fighting until you are safe to exist on this planet. This is to all my people. The sample was taken from Reverend R.C. Crenshaw and Congregation's Unidentified Lining Hymn. This is not available many places, so to hear it, check the reference section down below. There is strength in the Southern Black Church. In other churches, often our pain is minimized, ignored, played down, overlooked, pushed to the back. But in Black communities, in Black churches, we get to come together. Our pain is recognized, validated, acknowledged, and prayed over. This is so important. And that sample just reinforces that theme of spiritual strength amidst trials. When your congregation looks like you, there's this power, there's this strength, there's this solidarity. God is there. Where two or three are gathered in my name, there I am with them. And that's on Matthew 18:20. Our people have always been spiritual. We know that God is our refuge and strength, always present in times of trouble. Justice will be served, if not in this lifetime, then the next.
A bruised reed he will not break, and a faintly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be discouraged till he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his law.
Oh my gosh, I'm almost done. Beyonce and I have something in common. All Night is our favorite track. Let's start with the poetry. Grandmother the Alchemist spun gold from this hard life, found hope where it did not exist, discovered the antidote in her own kitchen, broke the curse with her own hands. You passed these instructions down to your daughter, who then passed it on to her daughter. It's so comforting to hear the voices of the elders. There's a clip from Jay-Z's grandmother, Patty, at her 90th birthday. During her birthday celebration speech, she said, I had my ups and downs, but I always find the inner strength to get back up. I was served lemons and I made lemonade. This speech is immortalized in the bridge. Beyonce takes note of this process of taking pain, of which you have no shortage, and creating something soothing, something refreshing out of it. In the video, she blinks and we hear that same song that she sung at the end of Pray You Catch Me, while jumping off the ledge. It's like here she's snapping out of that daze, that process of healing and grief that she was in. Finally, she's moving out of that on the other side, seeing the light at the end of the tunnel. This shift is also a movement from the past into the present. The generational curse has been broken, and now her family can move forward on a clean slate. My favorite line in the poetry is, if we're gonna heal, let it be glorious. The pre-chorus is very similar to Hold Up, except this time from a place of love. So many people wanna rub shoulders with Jay-Z, but they don't know the real him like she does. Yes, I love that part. And yes, it's gonna take some time for her to trust him again, but their love for each other is so real that they will always stay connected. This is the message of All Night. celebrates love of all kinds in all forms. It's so beautiful to look at. The most prominent sample is Spotty Oddy Dopalicious by Outkast. All night long. Oh, I love this song, guys. The annotation of the hook on Genius cites season 4 of Good Times when the family is preparing to move south. Now, if you're Hive, I know a whole bunch of bells are ringing off in your head. Season 4, Good Times, moving back to the south. I know. Maybe we're gonna see something in the future that links that. James Evans Sr.'s wife, Florida, was putting on a front after the funeral as if she wasn't affected by the loss. However, in a solitary moment, she hits a breaking point where she realizes James is truly gone. This scene has been cited as one of the realest moments in the series. Similarly, when Bea acknowledges her pain, her breakdown becomes a breakthrough. Lemonade is one of the most realest, most vulnerable albums ever created. And I'ma say it, she will forever be goated for Lemonade. Love keeps no record of wrongs. The hardest part is over and they're ready to move forward together. Now the sneaky sample is hidden in the first lines of verse 2. Our love was stronger than your pride. That was actually a sample of Sade's song, Love is Stronger Than Pride. And I'll read the lyrics, it's so beautiful. I won't pretend that I intend to stop living. I won't pretend I'm good at forgiving. But I can't hate you, although I've tried. I still really, really love you. That little sample adds to the underlying story. Even though at some point you had trouble, now you're moving forward together, and the love is real. Not only is this another case of B putting us onto some good music, but there's actually a connection to my poem, I Love You More Than I Could Ever Hate You. And I ain't even heard that song before. If I knew, I would have sampled it somehow. This just really made me love this song even more. B didn't give the last track a theme, but if I were to do so, the word that comes to mind is reminder. Formation is many things. A bop, it addresses the haters who love to demonize everything she touches, and it reminds her where she came from. Formation celebrates Beyoncé's blackness in a way that's authentic to her. Mama, daddy, Alabama. Mama, Louisiana. Here she's saying, I know who I am. Y'all can't tell me nothing. In Formation, B also let us know that she's protecting her family. She said, I got hot sauce in my bag. Y'all peeked at the back, right? In Hold Up, it said hot sauce. You saw that? All right, I just wanted to check. Beyonce has been famous for most of her life. Imagine how many voices are telling her who to be before she even knows who she is herself. There's a lot of expectations imposed on you. Perfectionism is a side effect before it becomes chronic. I empathize with B, who's previously mentioned her experience with perfectionism and constantly reinventing herself as an artist. This is what she told Vogue in 2018. My mother taught me the importance of not just being seen, but seeing myself. As the mother of two girls, it's important to me that they see themselves too. They don't have to be politically correct as long as they're authentic, respectful, compassionate, and empathetic. I want the same things for my son. I hope to teach my son not to fall victim to what the internet says he should be or how he should look. I'm accepting of who I am. I will continue to explore every inch of my soul and every part of my artistry. I want to learn more, teach more, and live in full. In the album Lemonade, Beyoncé tells a story rarely told, how painful, negative emotions that we often run from can actually become part of a beautiful, grander storyline. What was broken becomes stronger when you fill it with gold, just like the Kintsugi bowl seen in Sandcastles. All right, guys, that's all I got for you. Subscribe for more videos, stay classy, and stream Lemonade on all platforms.